Meta officially joins the AI race. The Facebook and Instagram owner on Tuesday released Llama, a free version of its artificial intelligence model, challenging OpenAI's ChatGPT and Google's Bard. What makes Llama unique from the rest of the field is its open source, meaning its inner workings can be tinkered with and modified by anyone. Meta CEO Mark Zuckerberg says open source is the way to go, as it drives innovation by enabling more developers to build with new technology.
China begins radiation testing imported seafood from Japan. The move is seen as Beijing's way of pressuring Tokyo not to proceed with its plan to release treated radioactive water from the crippled Fukushima nuclear plant into the sea. The testing has prolonged customs procedures, prompting some businesses in China to look for other sources of imported seafood. Tokyo aims to start discharging the Fukushima water this summer. Global economic activity is slowing and medium-term growth prospects remain weak. International Monetary Fund Chief Kristalina Georgieva made that statement during a meeting of financial leaders from the Group of 20 Nations. That's why she says the top priority remains to be bringing inflation down. She notes while there is progress on this front, the job is not yet done and monetary policy must stay the course. Now, Georgieva also says the IMF will work on rebuilding fiscal buffers and reforms to enhance growth as well as boost productivity. Here at home, the Asian Development Bank maintains its growth projection for the Philippines this year. But as Lady Vicentia tells us, it sees a slightly lower outlook for Southeast Asia.
The ADB projected a 6% economic growth for 2023 and a 6.2% economic growth for 2024, setting the same expectations from the ADB's last outlook in April. ADB forecasts that the Philippines will register the highest growth in developing Asia. Robust investment and in private consumption led the country's growth in the first quarter of 2023. Other factors mentioned by ADB are rising employment, expansion of production and retail sales, and increased private and public construction. Tourism is also seen as a strong driver of growth, as well as business process outsourcing and information services.
Some weakening external demand across the region. But in the Philippines case, I think that's been more than offset by consistent and strong domestic demand, public and private investment. It's certainly high growth, and there are some ingredients for high quality growth. Philippines is poised to tap into its demographic dividend. It's got the largest working age population, an average age of 23, English educated population for the most part. So all positives, macroeconomic fundamentals, as I said, are strong. There's still some ways to go in terms of human development, social development progress, particularly around lagging labor productivity.
ADB, however, projects inflation to remain elevated at 6.2% for 2023 and also maintained its earlier forecast that inflation will ease to 4% in 2024. For Southeast Asia, inflation forecast is slightly revised down to 4.3% from 4.4% for 2023 and 3.2% from 3.3% for 2024. ADB downgraded its growth forecast for Southeast Asia to 4.6% from 4.7% for 2023 and 5% for 2024, citing weaker global demand from manufactured export. It, however, remains optimistic with the improved labor market conditions and income across Southeast Asia and with the increased tourist arrival attributed to revenge travel.
Legal hurdles for the Maharlika Investment Fund and a privatization plan for Manila's main airport. Denise Dinsay now joins us for more. What's happening, Denise?
Thanks, Stanley. Now, the legality of the controversial law creating the Philippines' first sovereign wealth fund will be questioned before the Supreme Court. Progressive group Bayan Muna says it will file a petition against the Maharlika Investment Fund. Its chairperson, Nery Colmenares, says the move is meant to protect public funds from possible corruption and abuse. Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel also slamming the new law. He laid down possible grounds for a legal challenge against the MIF. They include alleged violation of BSP independence. Meanwhile, Senator Sherwin Gatchalian, who voted in favor of creating the sovereign fund, allayed fears surrounding the controversial measure.
Harlequin fund sa bidding. No, pwede silang bumili ng gamit na walang bidding. Hindi dadaan sa procurement laws natin. Tinanggal ng Senado yan. Unang version, hindi sila dadaan doon sa GCG. Ngayon, dadaan na sila. Ibig sabihin, lahat ng sweldo na pwede nilang ibigay, dapat i-approve muna ng gobyerno. Yung governance structure, inayos rin. No? Para mas, maganda yung pamamahala nitong pondo na ito.
The Finance Department says the implementing rules and regulations of the Maharlika Investment Fund would be done by September. It expects the fund to be fully operational by the end of 2024. The fund is touted as a means to prop up the economy and accelerate growth, as it allows government to use underutilized investable funds and earn from it to pay for various big-ticket projects without having to add to the fiscal and debt burden. Finance Chief Benjamin Diokno also clarifies he will only serve in an ex officio capacity and will not run the fund. An independent chairperson of the 9-member Maharlika board will manage it. The Philippine government approves a proposal to privatize Manila's main gateway, the Ninoy Aquino International Airport. Pia Gutierrez has the details. Pia?
The National Economic Development Authority Board on Wednesday has approved a solicited proposal for the rehabilitation, operation, expansion, and transfer of the Ninoy Aquino International Airport, which is expected to bring the country's main gateway to global standards. NEDA Chief Arsenio Balisacan, in a briefing, says the 170.6 billion NAIA PPP project is among the three infrastructure projects approved by the NEDA Board during a meeting in Malacanang with President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. earlier today. He says the goal of the project is to address long-standing issues at NAIA, such as the inadequate capacity of passenger terminal buildings and restricted aircraft movement. Once completed, the project, which covers the rehabilitation of all four terminals of the NAIA and its facilities, is expected to increase the airport's current annual capacity from 35 million to at least 62 million passengers and air traffic movement from 40 to 48 per hour. It is also expected to improve the overall passenger experience and service quality to prevent long queues, lengthy waiting time, and other passenger inconveniences. The NEDA chief also says that the start of the rehabilitation project will happen as soon as government selects the winning bidder. Also approved by the NEDA board is the construction of the second phase of the Samar Pacific Coastal Road worth 7.48 billion pesos. The project involves the construction of two bridges and the improvement of 15 kilometers of existing roads between Lawang Island and the mainland Samar Island. The NEDA board also approved the unsolicited proposal for the upgrade, expansion, operation, and maintenance of the Lagindingan International Airport in Misamis Oriental, which is expected to enhance regional development and promote tourism in northern Mindanao and its neighboring regions. Denise?
Pia Gutierrez with that report. Thanks, Pia. The Philippine Environment Department blames the public's behavior for the worsening plastic pollution in the country. A 2021 World Bank report had identified the Philippines as third among countries with the most mismanaged waste. For context, around 24% of the 61,000 metric tons of garbage generated every day is plastic. That's 14 million kilos of plastic every single day. The government has been taking some steps to minimize the use of plastics, including the creation of the Extended Producer Responsibility Law, which requires large companies to recover their plastic footprint. But the DENR asserts change needs to start with the ordinary people.
Filipinos utilize more than 163 million plastic sachet packets, 48 million shopping bags, and 45 million thin film bags daily, 33% of which is disposed of in landfills and dump sites, and around 35% actually is leaked into the open environment and, of course, into our oceans.
On the short term, siguro baka in the next 5 years we can get some results na on what we're doing institutionally, pwede yung mga procedures and processes, baka magkaroon na tayo ng mga introduction dyan. But in the long term, it has to be a lot of orchestrated efforts.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. says his administration remains committed to support micro, small, and medium enterprises, or MSMEs. In a statement at the MSME Summit, the president said government will provide relevant training and offer support for e-commerce platforms. He noted MSMEs make up 99% of all registered businesses in the country and employ at least 5.4 million Filipinos. During the summit, a new feature within the eGov Super App was launched. The Philippine e-commerce platform is meant to help MSMEs tap online markets to promote their products and services. The Philippine transportation sector sees a bumpy ride in the first year of the Marcos administration. Jackie Manaba tells us what issues hounded the sector in the past year.
The transportation sector experienced a bumpy ride in the first year of Marcos administration as the country reels from the impact of the global pandemic. The year of revenge travel was also hounded by fare hikes and high gasoline prices.
My order to the Department of Transportation, or DOTR, is really very simple. Full speed ahead.
In his first State of the Nation address, the Marcos administration vowed to continue the big-ticket projects of the past administrations. The list includes the longest and most expensive railway project, the North-South Commuter Railway Project, or NSCR, worth 873.62 billion pesos. The Department of Transportation has also continued the construction of the 12-kilometer LRT1 Cavite extension, the 23-kilometer MRT7, the Common Station, which will connect LRT1, MRT3, and MRT7, and the Metro Manila subway project worth 488 billion pesos.
Sabi niyo po ba, sir, na naka-full speed ahead ang DOTR nito first year ni President Marcos?
Yes, napaka-busy ng aming department sa dami ng mga projects na ini-implement namin, no? Marami kaming projects na namana natin sa previous administration na napaka-importante naman mga projects, no? Kaya naman pinipilit naming matapos din to ng maaga. Actually, yung mga projects na minana namin, this should have been finished even earlier, no? Naapektuhan lang din naman ng pandemic. But ngayon, wala nang pandemic, no? Walang reason para ma-delay ito, no?
Most of these projects will be finished before 2028, the end of the Marcos administration. But the Department of Transportation hits the brake on some transportation modes, including the oldest rail in the Philippines, the state-run Philippine National Railways. After Christmas this year, the whole PNR line will be gone to give way to the construction of the North-South Commuter Railway.
I would feel very, very, not really upset, but very sad because it's the most reliable form of transportation in going to Manila and vice versa. It has a historical value. Why? Because did you know that PNR operated since 1892?
The Marcos administration had its focus on the railways, which promises a cheaper way to commute.
It is clear in my mind that railways offer great potential as it continues to be the cheapest way of transporting goods and passengers. We can build upon already existing lines by modernizing these old railway systems. There are dozens of railway projects on the ground, above the ground, below ground, not just in Manila, but in other regions, at various stages of implementation and with a combined cost of 1.9 trillion pesos.
However, it was also under the Marcos administration that the free ride services, or Libreng Sakay, ended. No more free rides for passengers of EDSA Bus Carousel, Select Jeepney Routes, MRT3, and LRT2. It was also under the first year of Marcos a fare hike was approved for LRT1 and LRT2. The last fare hike for these urban railways was in 2015. And aside from the rail lines, the jeepneys, buses, and even taxis and CNVs hiked fares in October. Meanwhile, the Marcos administration inherited other problems from the past administration, like the fast depletion of vehicle plates and license cards.
Yeah, pipilitin nating mawala yung backlog na yan, no, with the procurement of these plates, no, and at the same time we will improve the production.
Jackie Manabat, ABS-CBN News.
At least 95% of public utility vehicle drivers will not join the three-day transport strike, which will coincide with President Marcos' State of the Nation address. That's according to the Philippine Transportation Department. The agency also refutes claims by some transport groups. Government has failed to address their concerns over the PUV modernization program.
Nakakalungkot at meron pa na threat, no, sa araw pa ng SONA ng ating Pangulo at nag-aakusa ng mga bagay na sinagot na ng LTFRB na walang basehan. Zero ang narinig ko. Wala akong narinig, wala nagsasabi na any transport cooperatives ay sasama sa WELGA. So, para sa amin sa DOTR, na-assure kami. So, we are humbled at masaya kami sa suporta ng mga transportation leaders.
The DOTR also reiterating it will not extend the deadline of the jeepney franchise consolidation.